I'm going to talk on a lot of trends that we see going into 14 and beyond. And a lot of the times, you'll hear me say this a couple times, that this is the future, but the future is also now. So we're going to articulate about some things that are really changing and are happening, you know, as we speak. And the first one that I'm going to talk about is the empowerment of the customer and how that shapes the new modern marketer. Basically, marketing, once upon a time, we were front of the funnel, right? We drove traffic into the retail store. We got people to pick up the phone and respond to the catalog. We got you to actually talk to a B2B sales rep, right? And most of the selling happened after marketing handed the baton off. Now, these customers, they research every piece of content, look at every webinar, look at every tutorial, comb you and your competitors' websites, look at ratings and reviews, look at social, look at commentaries. By the time you actually get to touch them in a store, or by the time you get a B2B sales rep on the phone with them, 80, 90% of the experience and 80, 90% of the decision has already been made. So that has put the responsibility for customer experience squarely on us, the marketer, like never before. In addition to those empowered customers, we've got so much more data that they're generating. It's going up exponentially, not linearly, and we're supposed to figure out what to do with that. 75% of the content out there are actually done by those customers now, completely out of your control. That's spiraling out, and what they say can either radically help your marketing efforts or it can radically hurt, depending on what people have to say about your product, your service, your company. And the fragmentation of the channels with which they can do this is like never before. And a third trend, what am I doing about this? I'm having to throw a lot of technology at it. And the CMO and the CIO are becoming kind of joined at the hip. They have to be if we're going to be successful in this. Marketing is more dependent on IT than they've ever been before. Marketing is spending more money on IT than they ever have before. And the demands on the organization to actually pull off my revenue and customer experience goals rely on a higher level of investment and sophistication and support out of these two. So, right, when I was growing up, marketing and IT didn't even know, you know, who they were. They never went to each other's offices. They rarely spoke. Marketing hid from IT and vice versa. Now they're in the same room all the time, and that is going to be a relationship that's mission critical for our businesses to succeed. Okay, so we as marketers, right, the customer experience responsibility for the business, the revenue responsibility for the business is increasingly on our shoulders. And Forrester just did a great write-up. Despite this fact, in the survey, 90% have been told that, okay, that's true, but you get to reallocate your existing budget and your existing resources and figure it all out. We're not going to give you new budget, new resources. 3/4 were given new responsibilities, and 3/4 were basically under the feeling that, okay, not only do I have to do this with the same amount of budget, with new responsibilities, but I'm actually getting judged. You know, the efficacy of what I'm doing is getting judged faster and harder than it has ever been before. So congratulations, guys. How's it feel to be a marketing exec? We're good stuff, right? Higher responsibilities, no more money, and you get judged on the efficacy or lack thereof a lot faster. So now we all want the same thing. 91% of executives that in this O'Keefe survey said, yes, of course. We want to be viewed as an industry leader for customer experience in our respective vertical industries. Makes sense, but there's a very, very big execution gap that exists. 38% said we have just gotten started with any kind of formal customer experience initiative in our company at all. And 16% said that we started and we are at some level of advanced. So the aspiration to be customer experience with our customer, you know, leaders with our customers versus how many of us have started, never mind gotten past stage one, is a massive gap. And the execution gaps are pretty pronounced. Lots of gaps. Inside your own organizations as the marketer, cultural alignment, organizational issues that are inhibiting your own organization from doing this, the fragmented channels that I mentioned, trying to drive experience and revenue from all those channels. I've got more data, but it's more disparate, and it's on the sideline more. I'm not using it anywhere near as effectively as I could. Siloed analytics, I can report on a campaign metric or program. I can't I can't get my hands from an analytics standpoint on overall programs across the overall marketing lifecycle and do cross-channel, you know, revenue attribution. I'm nowhere near ready for that. And I have thrown a lot of systems at this. I've got 50 different databases, 50 UIs, 50 single sign-on, you know, IDs, 50 teams working inside my organization and specialized. So we've thrown more and more and more systems to try to help us execute better. And ironically, a lot of us are executing less because we're crumbling under the weight of all those systems. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the trends that we are using to address these gaps. I'm going to start with data activation. What I mean by that is essentially, let's just get the data off of the sidelines. Data, you know, is sitting over there in these big piles, gleaming with potential, waiting to be used to drive customer experience and marketing. But the data kind of sits over there and ages like fish. It doesn't age like wine. Right, so it's just over there, it gets old, it gets smelly, and it doesn't get in the game to help drive programs. And the first thing that we need to do is fix that problem. And hopefully the slide will come back. It's funny. So pretend you see a business card up there. Pretend you see Nick up there. I need to know Nick, my customer. That customer, Nick, he has bought a product for me. Any luck? Yeah, okay. He's bought a product from me 3 years ago. That's the only product he ever bought. He never bought again. He never has called customer service. He never registered it. He's never put any, you know, content into the forum. He's never said anything UGC on the communities. You know, that's Nick. The same Nick is the guy that literally is all over social media, you know, on Twitter and Facebook about that particular product group, literally on a daily basis. He spends over 10 hours a week on websites specific to that product group. And he clicks on a lot of banner advertising, all of which consumes retargeting premiums specific to that product group. I've got to know that that's all the same Nick, right? I have to put all that together so that I know when I'm talking to Nick next in my marketing programs, how I can actually read that digital body language and communicate to Nick in the right channel in the right way. And quite frankly, I need to help my VP of sales and my VP of service know all this so that they can talk to Nick as well. So that's it's kind of, you know, that has to happen. They say necessity is the mother of invention. We've been talking about getting the data together so that we can actually have a profile to do this for 2.5 decades. People are finally done talking, and we are finally getting it to the point where we are putting it together, and we're going to start having what I call on the screen is a very pretty picture of a universal customer profiles. Stellar graphics, guys. The visuals were kick butt. The second visual, which we may or may not see, is to do that, data management is a big hassle, right? Another big trend is that this data management and data aggregation is going to move up into the cloud, finally. Right? Anybody been through a MDM initiative or a big data warehousing initiative? Got scar tissue from it, right? That data warehouse or that MDM might as well be the Pacific Ocean away from the actual digital channels like search or display, you know, that you're trying to use it in, or SaaS applications in the cloud like, you know, marketing automation, right? So that has got to finally fix itself. Let's see if this works now. See, isn't that pretty? Is that a beautiful profile or what? So all of that data, right, the third-party cookie data, the first-party data you have in your systems, the third-party data from Nielsen or D&B or whatever, the social data, has all got to come up, the marketing data, so that you can do what we just talked about on that first slide. And it's got to go through the same privacy, governance, mastering, you know, normalization, standardization, customer communication frequency, preferencing, right? It's got to go through the machine. But it's got to be aggregated from all the right sources to have that universal customer profile go through the machine and sit up there in the cloud so that it is literally working in real time with all of those channels and with all those applications. And that, again, that hasn't happened yet. We're dealing with that Pacific Ocean, but you are seeing a lot of research on this. You're seeing a lot of customers actually invest in it. You'll be reading, you'll be hearing a lot from the vendor community about actually getting data management out of that dungeon and up into the cloud where it's interacting with the channels and the applications that your customers are using. We're going to see hubs go away, right? This person, Omniture, is this person's master database. Salesforce.com is this master database. Eloqua is this master database. Google Analytics is this master database. We have 20 masters and no slaves, right? Everything's a master, and it adds to the incredible confusion. It's going to go from this to this, right, where I'm going to have one hub. And then I will literally manage the customer data, and I will feed out and then be fed back in all of these applications and channels to pull this off. So a lot's going to happen with data, because data has been one of the number one inhibitors for us to actually go do the kind of customer experience across channel and across lifecycle that we wanted. We're finally going to fix data. Big trend number two is the evolution of content marketing, and a lot of speakers have actually talked about that today. I like to actually talk about the trend. It's not just content management, it's content marketing. And spend a minute on that. We all agree that content is king, right? We're marketers, so we still do agree with that. Nobody raised their hand. Okay, good. Yeah, content is king, right? But what's content usually mean? I have a few people in my company that are approved to do content, or I have an agency do some content. So this little set of content gets approved. I then tag it like, okay, geo segment equals US. Business segment equals SMB, and product group equals applications. So I give it three little labels, I stash it away in an enterprise content management system, and there I go, right? I've got content management. And then it's up to marketers to figure out, okay, right, what do I do with that? All of the good stuff over here, all of your customers, all of your competitors, all of researchers, analysts, public opinion, there's massive amounts of content out there in social, in blogs, in communities, in reports, and write-ups, and tutorials, in press releases. There is so much content out there being derived by everybody. It is in real time, so it is hyper-current, and it is hyper-relevant if you find through it, and in many cases is far more influential to your customers and whatever you're trying to do from a CX standpoint with them than the stuff that you had the agency do and meta-tagged and stuffed in the enterprise system. So, that's, you know, one of the big differences is I'm actually going to get all of the content out there, sort through what's relevant to my audiences, and curate it and put content marketing on top of content management very, very intelligently. You know, again, the people that are doing content marketing already are scoring it. So if that's segment one, that's a segment one customer, right? However I've segmented, you may have 8 customer segments, you may have 38 customer segments. This is an acquisition effort for segment one. Where is all the content that actually scores 9.5 or higher, you know, to actually be in the acquisition lifecycle for segment number one, right? And I use that content. Segment, you know, content number two, that scores 8.5 or 9 for segments 3, 7, and 12 in a conversion, you know, campaign. So let's use all that content. And then over here, segment number 9, I'm in a, let's upgrade them into a loyalty program. Where is the content that scores 10 out of 10 for that life cycle for that customer segment? So you literally have content intelligent with your personas, your marketing segments, which drives the efficacy of that content through the roof. Second, the trend is already happening that, let's say I do a website traffic campaign, you know, once a week, right? Or a lead gen campaign if I'm B2B once a week. If I did any more than that, my open rates, my click-through rates, and the results, you know, would just go away. Now, if I'm using all of the content, scoring it the right way, I've got something new with a relevancy score of 9 or higher, and I can literally do that lead gen campaign or that website or store traffic campaign every single day and not have that degradation of open rate, click-through rate, you know, unsub, et cetera, because I'm literally doing something that current, that relevant every single day and driving bigger results. And the people that are really on the cutting edge of this are literally using the content to actually drive the campaign itself. So it doesn't matter what the calendar said. If I see and curate a 10 out of 10 score, that will actually drive the campaign in itself. Don't ask, just go, right? I see 10 out of 10, so go grab every name in the database that is in segment one that maps to this level 10 relevant score and push it out right now because it will be really, really effective in store traffic or lead gen or whatever the case may be. So you're watching content go from something you did at the very last after segmentation and everything else like that, and then let's attach the HTML to content literally driving customer upgrades, you know, customer conversion, and customer acquisition. So it's a very, very fundamental change. And the people that are doing it are being very effective. And when you've got the data piece that we just talked about and the intelligent contact piece, then all of a sudden we can do this thing, you know, this unicorn that we've all read about and heard about and seen movies about, but haven't really watched one exist, which is a marketer that's actually delivering the right content to the right person in the right channel, right, at the right time, all in an automated fashion. It's not going to be a unicorn anymore. 2014 is when the unicorn becomes real, and we are actually going to execute and pull this stuff off because of what we're doing with the data trend and the content trend. Real quick, I mentioned this, but we're also going to realize that every customer has kind of been digitized. So whether I am a consumer that is going to spend 4 minutes deciding whether to buy a $40 pair of shoes in pure B2C land, or whether I'm a customer that's going to make a decision over 4 months on a $4 million piece of manufacturing equipment or database technology, I'm doing the exact same things. I'm doing all of the research. I'm doing all the websites. I'm looking at all the social proofing. I'm looking at everything that I can actually do. And that sales, that consideration cycle may be 4 minutes, right? But I am going to do that 4 minutes to go to three sites, to Twitter, to Yelp, to Price Comparison Engine, and to two competitors' websites. And I'll make that considered purchase for $40 in 4 minutes over here. I will actually make that considered purchase over 4 months, you know, over here. But it's all digital, it's all omni-channel, and every single thing you're doing, no matter how small ticket and fast or how big ticket and long, is now a considered purchase, and you need to actually touch the customer that way, okay? We're gonna stop doing things in silos. Advertising is in silos here, the loyalty program is here, the loyalty program is in a silo here. Even with marketing automation, which has gotten a lot of discussion today, that in B2C land, that means push a campaign, get them to the website, and then get them to the shopping cart. In B2B land, that means push a campaign, get them to a landing page, hand them off to a sales rep. That's all done in complete silos right now. The marketing automation systems, whatever you use, right, are now going to actually broaden across the entire life cycle and go across all of the channels. I'm going to plan display, mobile, social, my call, et cetera, from one control panel, and I'm going to use it across the life cycle. And one very interesting thing, that has a lot of ramifications, but another trend that's pretty interesting is, you know, this thing called ads that we spent. Last time I read, I think it's $107 billion on these things, these digital ads. They're not just going to be ads anymore. They are now going to be parts of intelligent, multi-channel, multi-touch campaigns throughout the entire life cycle. So instead of just touching somebody, right, with an email or a landing page, they're going to see the same offer, right, in display. They're going to see the same in social. They're going to see the same in mobile, et cetera. And the people that are actually doing this already are seeing really, really radical double and triple digit increases in the efficacy of their multi-channel marketing campaigns, right, from prospect through to advocacy. And by bringing these over and being able to actually target the display, target the social, target the mobile with all the first party data that I've got, you know, once I'm doing something other than just behavioral or third-party cookie data, I'm seeing triple-digit increases, you know, 1,000% plus in the efficacy of these things that I spend so much money on, like mobile advertising and like display advertising. So that world that is very tight right now, this is advertising and this is marketing, is pretty much done, guys, in 14. We're going to start thinking about them not as not just ads anymore, but as critical touch points in a multi-channel, multi-life cycle stage, and drive the efficacy of the spend on these things through the roof in the process. Two final points. One, even though we're all cloudy, you know, it's all SaaS-y, it's all, you know, up here now, it's not on-premise for the most part. That's an overgeneralization, there's still a lot of on-premise. I still have to buy a lot of technology to do a lot of things to pull off this customer experience and drive revenue stuff, right? Even this simple depiction, you start thinking about all the organizational silos. And if I have to go, even in SaaS land, and if myself and my head of IT that are glued to the hip now have to actually go implement all those, you know, manage workflow, manage the data model, manage the systems integration, manage the UI, manage the reporting synergies, I still am talking about, you know, overall man years and millions of dollars and lots and lots and lots of time to stitch all this stuff together. What's happening out there is the vendors have figured that out, right? And you're starting to see ecosystems. And Salesforce.com is a good example. If anybody's a Salesforce, you know, AppExchange is a good example where you've got about 1,700 apps, and I can pick an app, and for the most part, it's integrated and it will work, right? That's happening out here in marketing as well. So you're going to be able to say, okay, I can actually go do all of that, all of the integration, all of the data, all of the workflow, all the UI has been pre-integrated for me. And I can now get to value and actually execute my program. So this is going to fundamentally shape what the vendors are doing, right? Because it's going to benefit you in a big way as a vendor to be part of an ecosystem or in the middle of an ecosystem in our situation. And it's certainly going to impact the way you buy, right? Because the pain of you having to spend 7 months and 7 full-time FEs and $700,000 to do stitching yourself versus nope, I've bought things that are seamlessly integrated and are part of the ecosystem is gonna really determine how modern marketers buy technology as well. I have talked with 200 or 300 CEOs and 200 or 300 CMOs just in the last 4 months. I think this stat is actually 99.5. Every CFO and CEO I know wants more accountability, more ROI focus from marketing. So I think this is a very liberal stat. We basically need to deliver now as marketers, and we need to prove the value of every penny we spend and every investment we make. But we're really not ready. So you look at a lot of the surveys, and not only are people saying, well, I'm just not ready from a tool standpoint or an application standpoint, but as importantly, I don't have the right people or the right skills inside my organization. So even if you did give me wave the magic wand and gave me the cure for cancer, you know, from an analytics solution, I don't have the right skills and skill sets. So you're going to see another trend is going to be another massive wave. And we've already had 2 or 3 massive waves of investments in analytics. But with the new analytics on the new channels, the new ways you need to do things, you're going to see a big, big investment in tools and in the people that have the skill sets to do them. And we're not going to be allowed to just have marketing metrics anymore, right? We're going to have to go from just campaign metrics to measuring analytics across the whole program. And if we do what I just talked about, we're going to have to actually finally get able to do cross-channel attribution. So I can say from prospect to first purchase to loyalty, that whole life cycle, and I hit them with display and with search and with mobile and with landing pages and with web and with email. What did I do, right? And how can I optimize it? So we're going to have to actually solve the problem, and people are doing this with cross-channel. And then finally, it's not going to be enough to have marketing metrics anymore. Those are going to have to be directly and unarguably tied to the business metrics, right? How did that marketing metric actually drive the P&L or drive the stock price or drive the earnings per share? Because too much right now, there's still marketing metrics that are great. They make pretty PowerPoint slides, but we don't directly attribute to how well they actually drove the business. The one gratuitous slide, we invest heavily in this. That's it. can't advertise here. But all these trends is a big part of what's driving my group, because I run the marketing cloud, which is all the technology solutions for the marketer, as well as then branch out into the technology solutions for sales, for service, for commerce, et cetera. And then finally, the trend is, a lot of you out there, right, you've got a VP of social, a VP of loyalty, a VP of ads, a VP of mobile, VP of community, VP of CRM, VP of loyalty. You're in so many silos. And Nick, that customer, he doesn't really care, right? If you've got 10 different databases and Nick's a different guy with different attributes, and you're motivated on your MBO to get this out of Nick, and you're motivated to get this out of Nick, and you're motivated to get this out of Nick, Nick is going to demand a good, fulfilling, consistent, experience from your organization, no matter what channel, and no matter whose MBO, he's attached to, who's a VP inside your organization. So while expertise will maintain in all these things, but the specialization will be important, those walls have got to get softer, a little bit more fungible, so that data, best practices, ideas, and information, around Nick can actually flow. So alignment, incentives, kind of just a culture of sharing, and a little bit, if not breaking down the silos, at least making them a little bit fungible so stuff can marry across. So that was the last of the trends. I think we've only got a couple minutes left, but happy to take any questions if anybody's got them before I step down. You want my personal opinion? How many VPs of mobile are on the stage? This is a scary one. The question was, do I really think that the VP of mobile will continue to be a silo in the organization chart all the way up to VP? My personal opinion, I'm not speaking on behalf of the company, but I've been a marketer for 25 years. I've earned every one of these thin gray hairs I've got. And I don't think so. I think that we go through these, right? The web was a separate strategy. Now the web's just a storefront, right? And an email was a separate strategy. Now it's not. Things like social, the form factor, and what you need to do and recognize who's active in it is something, but it's at the end of the day, it's a channel that needs to be consistent across all the others. And the form factor in mobile and what you need to do right in mobile apps versus SMS versus push versus mobile client, and how I need to actually deal with the nuances of a smartphone versus a tablet, all of those are very, very important, you know, form factor and user experience decisions. But at the end of the day, NIC, if you treat NIC different, you know, in mobile, and get so obsessed with that, and it's inconsistent with every other way in which he touches you, whether it's the store, or the phone, or the catalog, or the web, or the, you know, social network. I think that people are going to realize that while getting the nuances of that particular form factor right are mission critical, it's actually not a strategy, it's a channel. And I need to touch Nick consistently in that mobile channel, just like I'm touching him with web and with social and with you know, email. So that's my personal opinion, is we're another wave of things that used to be change the world strategies are going to slowly morph into, nope, that's just another important digital channel that I need to, you know, manage consistently, holistically this way. Any other questions? You know, microphone here, right?
Hi, I'm wondering about the consolidated marketing technology stack versus choosing, you know, independent point solutions that are woven together with APIs.
Yeah, that's a great, in all this arms race that the vendors, you know, are undertaking right now, and I'm guilty, I made two acquisitions myself last quarter, and I'm not done. I'm not done buying toys. If all it is integration or acquisition for acquisition's sake, to stack up more logos in a cloud, you know, PowerPoint slide, and say, look, I have more, that's not going to move anything at all. The people that get this right are going to actually derive an amazing amount of value to the buyer. You know, because I put peanut butter and chocolate together and I seamlessly integrated them, I got this amazing peanut butter cup, you know, at the back, right? So, or 1 + 1 = 10 instead of 2. Pick your corny analogy. But the people, the stack concept will win out over the point solution concept if and when the people that are doing the stacks are creating that 1 + 1 = 10, because the value of having, right, that data, that content, that workflow, that UI, that analytics, that one throat to choke, right? If the marketer doesn't see value, they're going to continue to just buy best of breed. If the marketer does see value and cannot deal with 20 databases and 20 teams and 20 UIs and 20 tools, and they're hungry to do that, right? Because who wants to continue to manage 20 tools if I'm a marketer, right? The trend is towards this consolidation because there's so much pain about how discrete everything is. So if the vendors get it right and alleviate pain and create value, then I think you'll see a heavy float to the stacks. But then those stacks are all still going to have to be heavily interoperable with other stacks or other apps, right? You're not going to see one software vendor conquer the world. So even if I've got a great marketing stack with 15 things in it, it may talk to a different Salesforce automation stack or a different ERP stack or a different, you know, business intelligence stack, right? So even the stacks have to be interoperable and integratable. Yeah. Any other, do we have time for another one?
Kevin, I think we have to.
Okay, great. Thank you, everyone. Nice to see you.